You can sense its looming presence just beneath the water's surface, waiting, appearing as harmless as a floating log. It is an elusive creature, surrounded by myth and eerie tales of mysterious disappearances and vicious attacks. So little is known about the habits and history of this primitive being. It's been referred to as a living fossil. It is called the Alligator Gar. Gars are primitive fishes and are related to the bowfin in the superorder Holostei. There are about 7 species which are restricted to North and Central America, ranging from southern Canada and continuing southward to Cuba and Central America. 4 of the most common species found in the United States are the long-nosed gar, the short-nosed gar, the spotted gar, and the alligator gar. They are freshwater inhabitants and can tolerate high salinities. They're commonly found in warm, sluggish backwaters of lowland rivers and lakes, in swamps, and in brackish waters. Alligator gars are known to have entered coastal bays and have even been seen in the Gulf of Mexico. David Schlesser is an aquatic biologist with the Dallas Aquarium in Fair Park. He's in charge of the care and well-being of the aquarium exhibits, which include several species of exotic and unusual fishes.
To me, gars are among the most interesting of fish. I particularly like primitive fish. I think we should mention right here that when people hear an animal referred to as a primitive animal, they tend to think it hasn't been perfected. It hasn't advanced to a modern state. And this is just the opposite of the way they should look at it. If something that evolved millions and millions of years ago is still alive, it obviously evolved into a state of perfection if it still survives to this day. So primitive just means that it's been around a long time and evolved a long time ago, not that the animal isn't fully developed, so to speak.
Dr. Neil Smotresk is an associate professor of biology at the University of Texas at Arlington. His position as a biologist at UTA involves teaching graduate and undergraduate students and research in respiratory neurobiology. The garfish has played a significant role in his research on how animals breathe.
One of the reasons these gar are really interesting to biologists is because they're very primitive. There's so few species of gar and the amia in the world that they are important for us to try to understand. They're a link between the scientific researcher of today and the past. One of the reasons they're still around today is because they have the ability to breathe both air and water. They can breathe water with gills like any fish, but they breathe air with a lung.
Mike Costello, an inland fisheries biologist for Texas Parks and Wildlife Department, has been conducting research on the alligator gar population at the Choke Canyon Reservoir in South Texas.
Okay, the gar do really well in our southern impoundments, our lowland impoundments, the rivers and swamps, ponds, lakes, reservoirs, you name it, you're going to find some alligator gar in it. There are several reasons for that, actually, why they do so well. Number one is they can breathe atmospheric oxygen. Not many fish can do that. Consequently, a gar can live in very stagnant water with very little dissolved oxygen where other fish couldn't live. You combine that with the fact that it's so well armored, with the tough ganoid scales, the hard bony head, plus the fact that, you know, alligator gar can live 30 to 40 years, you can get a body of water with a lot of large alligator gar in it, and they do really well.
In 1986, Paul Seidensticker with the Texas Parks and Wildlife Department conducted research on the food selection of the alligator gar and long-nosed gar on Lake Sam Rayburn in East Texas.
We had a lot of complaints from Lake Sam Rayburn fishermen that the alligator gar were eating all the bass and crappie, and there just wasn't anything left for the fishermen up there. And so we decided that, well, we ought to look into what was happening, because we knew there was a large population of big gar in Sam Rayburn. And so we spent 4 weeks in September and October of 1986 catching these fish and seeing what they'd been feeding on.
What a good one! Look at that!
We did this with the help of local fishermen and other biologists from around the state. And over this period of time, we caught like 210 large alligator gar. An alligator gar will eat anything he can get his mouth on, quite honestly. We found 17 different species of fish in these gar, not to mention a lot of odds and ends like ducks and coots and trash bags and filleted carcasses of fish that people, the fishermen, had thrown out. As far as the actual species of fish that they ate, the main thing was a gizzard shad and freshwater drum and channel catfish. Very few bass were picked up. I think we caught like, or we found like three bass in these gar stomachs. The first studies that were done on alligator gar were done up in Michigan and Wisconsin area. The fishermen complained about them eating all their fish up there too. They found about the same thing that we found when they checked the food habits up there, was that they're pretty indiscriminate about what they feed on.
Gars, in preference, are not a speed demon grab predator like barracudas or pike. They tend to wait and lurk around and look for an easy catch. This could be dead and dying fish, scavenging. They've been known to feed sometimes on even water birds that at night are sleeping on the surface of the water that sneak up to. Most of our game fish, like the striped bass, are pelagic, meaning they're open water, constantly swimming fish. Their habitat wouldn't mix that much with gars, except maybe at the base of dams, where we keep these fish from migrating and they all jam up. This largemouth bass and the other black basses are very alert, and it would be very hard for an alligator gar to sneak up on a largemouth bass. But even if they do take a few of them, why should we decide that an animal doesn't belong because we want to take all of them? I mean, people should be educated that everything has a place. Being such a primitive animal, I think it behooves us that man isn't the cause of its demise. And unfortunately, since in most parts of the world, in country, I should say, the United States, gars are not considered a choice eating fish. In certain areas of the South, this differs, but most areas they're considered, I hate to use the term, but they call them trash fish, meaning that they're not good for sport, they're not good to eat, and they eat other fish. And when fishermen catch them, they just throw them up on the bank to die, or break their jaws and throw them back in the water to slowly starve to death. I mean, to me, this is absolutely appalling. The bottom line being that the gars don't choose, on preference, the kind of fish that man chooses as a game fish by preference. And their habitats are not the same by preference.
We got a lot of complaints about large alligator gar here. A lot of fishermen felt that they were eating fish and generally being a nuisance. So what we did is allowed the sale of fish here. So the means they're using, they're not really commercial in the sense that they're using gill nets or hoop nets or trap nets. They're commercial in the sense that they're actually allowed to sell the fish now under a permit issued by the Parks and Wildlife Department. It's a temporary permit that's going to last a year. What I do is with these fish they catch is I analyze the stomach contents. So far we're finding what we found before, that they generally just, they don't eat sport fish. What we try to do is optimize fishing for everybody. That's the Parks and Wildlife goal. We see gar as a resource that is not utilized right now and that can be utilized.
At first glance, seeing gar as a resource to utilize can be taxing on the imagination. Especially when, more often than not, gar are considered worthless. That is, when they are considered at all. Webster's third new international dictionary includes the following definition of alligator gar. Any of certain related Cuban and Central American fishes that are all valueless as food or game fishes and considered destructive of aquatic life and waterfowls. There are other reference books with similar definitions. So why the commercial interest?
But what these gentlemen here are doing is they're culling the population down. They don't want to eliminate the gar, but what they want to do is remove some of them. This is a resource that wasn't utilized in the past, and now we can utilize it. They're selling this meat and making good money at it. The Choke Canyon Conservation Association, they earmarked 10% of the monies from the sale of these fish that goes to a fund that, like I said, it's earmarked for nursery ponds. What they want to do is raise bass, stock some bass fry, and grow them out to about 4 inches and actually stock them in the lake. So while they're taking from the lake, they're also giving to it.
Yeah. Oh, baby!
Yeah. You know, there's other uses that as this program progresses, I'm sure, you know, there's a few local people have explored the ideas of tanning the hides and making earrings and jewelry. It's an untapped resource that's just now starting to be explored.
Gars have scales that are different from the scales of most more modern fish. They have scales called ganoid scales because of the presence of a hard substance called ganoin. And these scales are so hard that a lot of the Native American Indians used gar scales as arrowheads, and they covered their shields with gar skins to repel the spears and arrows of attacking tribes. When the Americans started busting the sod in the Midwest, it was very difficult to get equipment sent out here. And they were trying to get steel plows, but they were unavailable. So they learned from the Indians that they could cover wooden plows with gar skins because they were so hard and durable. And so gar skins helped bust the sod of the Midwest.
Once a gar attains the size of a 3 or 4 feet, there's not much that's going to prey on an alligator gar except man. It's classified as a non-game fish in Texas, so there are no size or bag limits on the fish. And since the fish does have a reputation for being fairly good eating and in a lot of areas of the country, particularly the south, there is a large commercial fishery for these big gar. It started in Louisiana, it's kind of moved into Texas.
Now we want to show you what the finished product is of a hard night's or hard day's fishing. We got Rusty Rankin with me, who owns a commercial license down here on Choke Canyon. Now Rusty, that is really some pretty white meat. I'm really surprised with the color of the meat.
It'd make a good fillet out of that.
Now this is off of one gar right here. How big was this particular fish?
It was about a 100-pound fish.
Okay, now on a 100-pound fish on average, what kind of yield are you going to get as far as edible meat that you can take to market?
You're getting about 50% of it will be meat that you can take in.
Fantastic. So that's how you put her on the truck right this. We get it on some ice, get it cooled down.
Yeah. One thing about gar, it spoils fast, so you have to clean it, keep it in the shade, clean it, and get it right on ice.
The most I've cleaned in one day was 500. I cleaned 585 pounds.
The meat is usually sold to wholesalers and distributed to local fish markets and grocery stores in areas where consumer demand exists. For example, fresh gar fillets are popular in the Rio Grande Valley and retail anywhere from $2.99 to $3.29 a pound.
As far as gars as a food fish and whether they should be farm raised or just caught from the wild and used as a food fish, the gar is a relatively slow growing fish. When I say relatively slow growing, they might achieve a size of 10 inches by the first year, but to get them to a commercially feasible size would take a number of years. They also feed on fish, and they would have to be fed a fish diet. They couldn't be raised so inexpensively as, say, catfish or carp, which are basically vegetarian or omnivorous and can be fed on a pellet made of a meal of soy, protein, and other things that are relatively inexpensive. So we're talking about something that would be relatively expensive to raise and would take a relatively long time to raise. This always brings on a problem, and the problem being economics. So then we get back to, well, should we commercially permit commercial harvesting of them to be sold for food? And we've had this problem in the past for a lot of things. We're addressing that situation right now with sharks. Shark steaks are getting to be really the epitome of cuisine right now, and shark numbers are crashing. This, to many people, thinks is wonderful. Let's get rid of them all. Now we're getting back to the discussion of, does an animal, just because it competes with man, not have a place on this planet? And I think very shortly we're going to see regulation on shark fishing. Maybe gars have to have a season where you only can catch them a certain season, or maybe a limit of numbers or sizes, leaving the adults to reproduce like we have on lobsters. But just to rape them out of the wild until they're gone for the use of man and put on the table when they're not essential part of the diet, I think sooner or later, and probably sooner, we're going to have to address that issue.
Really important. Ian Hiller is a senior curator at the Aquarium of the Americas in New Orleans, Louisiana.
The fresh and saltwater marshlands are in trouble, and these are tied to our marshlands quite a bit. The gar itself is doing fairly well. It's a fairly good predator. You never find the really large ones like they used to be, so that has got us concerned. Right now, there are some plans within the state of Louisiana for tagging, and that's the thing you have to do. To be able to study these a long time, you need to tag the animals with dates now, known dimensions, you know, the length, the width, and the weight. And then when the tag is recovered, X number of years down, you can compare and get a growth rate. And once you got a good growth rate of different sizes of the fish, then you can extrapolate from there and figure out an 8-foot gar is X number of years old.
Texas record and the world record are the same since they both came from the Rio Grande River back in the 1950s. The rod and reel record weighed 290 pounds and the trot line or unrestricted division weighed 302 pounds. These fish measure just a little over 7.5 feet long. What you find is that 7.5 to 8 feet is probably the maximum length on a gar, an alligator gar. The fish that we were catching that weighed 125 to 150 pounds were also about 7.5 feet long. So when they reach that stage, they tend to get bigger around. When we had the large population of gar on Sam Rayburn, the number of people that fish for them was increasing every year. Bow fishermen love to fish for them. Rod and reel fishermen like to fish for them. It's an extremely exciting fish to catch, and it has its own following of fishermen, but the number is real low, and I don't foresee it being made a protected sport fish with limits. But although the fish is worthy of it, the primary emphasis on fishing is bass, crappie, and catfish.
The large size and sinister appearance of the alligator gar would, in itself, lend some validity to the stories of gar attacks. Scary stories, often told by river fishermen, are passed along in eerie tales about swamps and bayous.
We had several stories on Sam Rayburn about 10 years ago of people that got bitten. One was a fisherman who was wading, as you said. They had a stringer of fish, and he supposedly got bit on the thigh by one of these gar. We also had a young boy who had bitten on the foot while he was swimming. This could have been any kind of gar. It wasn't necessarily an alligator gar. We've had several reports like this. And after it seemed like they got more frequent. We had about 4 or 5 of these, so I contacted all the fisheries people in Texas to see if they'd ever heard of this on any of their lakes, and all I got was negative reports from everybody. No one had ever heard of a gar attacking a swimmer or a fisherman anywhere in Texas.
Have they ever attacked people?
No, it's a real nice rumor to come up with. You get this big lurking beast just under the waterline, but I've never heard of any true accounts where they've attacked. A lot of people say, you know, my cousin 3 years ago or this or that. You hear all these stories, but it's never happened that I know of. Now, people have been injured when they throw them onto their boat deck and the animal's scared and it's snapping at everything that moves. But as far as being attacked while swimming, or falling into the water with a bunch of them, it's pretty unlikely.
Well, one of the things that you do want to worry about with the gar, though, is if you are fishing for them, either with rod and reel or jug lines or bow fishing or whatever, so these are big fish and they are dangerous when you get them in the boat or when you're trying to boat them. They've got a full set of teeth, like you said. They're large fish, very strong. If they do happen to get a hold of a leg or a foot in the boat, they tend to roll and twist, and they can be quite damaging to you if in the boat. So you want to
That's big fish.
Slow them down somehow before you put them in the boat, or be extreme, use extreme care.
Calm them down, because I tell you what, that may look cruel, but cruel is when you put these 50, 60 pound alligator gars in the boat with two fishermen. That's when it gets bad. So you've got to kind of stun him.
Gars, like other fish, are cold-blooded animals, which means their body temperature is dependent on their environment. Coming from a temperate area, in the winter, their water temperature, and therefore their body temperature, is a lot cooler. And since most of our food is used to maintain our body temperature, not for energy to move around, as a fish's body temperature drops, their need for food drops. Therefore, we've noticed here that our gars have much less of an appetite and are much less responsive to food in the winter. And if we fed them heavily in the winter, they become obese very easily because their excess food is going into fat. We find this particularly interesting since our water temperature doesn't change much in the seasons, but they are exposed to day length changes by skylights. And this seems to be enough to indicate to them when it's spring, when it's summer, when it's fall. Gars also breed in early spring, and we notice that during the winter, our female gars get quite heavy because it's the winter season, they develop their eggs within their body. And in the spring, we notice the species that we have pairs of, that the males pursue and court the females. We've never had a successful spawning here, though.
There is a toxin in the gar egg that's harmful to humans, makes you quite ill. Could even be fatal. I think there was one instance in Oklahoma where a person did die from eating gar eggs. There was a fisheries biologist in Oklahoma that decided he would test this theory one day, and he got extremely sick from trying this. So I do not eat gar eggs of any kind.
These are some baby gar. You can see the yolk sac still in this gar right here. You can see how big their eyes are. Even at this early age, these gar aren't completely aquatic like their other fish relatives. From the moment we got them into the lab, we saw them trying to surface breathe, trying to air breathe. One of the hard parts for them is that it's hard for them to break the water surface tension. And they have a sharp little hook, and it's difficult to see here, on the edge of their gill. They'll slide up to the water surface, and they'll use this sharp part of their gill to break the surface tension. They'll put their little mouths above water and they'll take a small breath into their relatively undeveloped lung. One of the real giveaways that this is a very, very primitive fish is the way their tail looks. If you look at this tail here, it's sharp and pointed on the top, and on the bottom, it looks more like a regular tail fin. We call that a heterocercal tail, and it's the same kind of characteristics that some sharks have. Most people first see gar when they're standing by the edge of a river in the summertime, and in the summertime it's very hot. When it's hot, gar have to air breathe more. They'll come up, you'll see a great big splash. That's called breaking. That breaking motion is actually an air breath. They have to stick their mouth out of water and take a gulp of the air. Now, what we're interested in is the lung of this gar and their gills and how they work, how they manage to breathe air into water. And in order to do that, we have to be able to sample the gases that go into their lung. It's technically called a swim bladder lung. The swim bladder lung runs the full length of their body. It's connected to their mouth through a little tiny pneumatic duct. Now they use their lung for more than just breathing. They also use their lung to help make them float. So it's a buoyancy device as well. The gar has to be able to swim through the water, move up and down, and be the right weight in the water, the right specific gravity. They have some other interesting tricks too. If you look at the front of the nose here, on any gar, long nose gar, spotted gar, it doesn't matter. They have a very sensitive sense of smell. And that sense of smell, in fact, you can see the nerves right through the thin roof of their mouth. If you see these bands running along right here, those are their olfactory nerves, the nerves that carry the sense of smell information to their brain. In fact, some researchers really prize long-nosed gar because they have the longest olfactory nerve that can be found readily in the animal kingdom. But out here at the end of their nose, they can sense chemicals. Now imagine a long-nosed gar with a nose out to about here, effectively has a nose that's like a remote probe out into the environment. If he swims along into an area that has a noxious chemical in it, or an area that has something that could potentially harm him if it got into his mouth, that nose senses it. Because they're an air-breathing fish, they can stop gill breathing for a while and protect their gills, and they can air breathe instead. Another thing that's kind of interesting about gar is they're fantastically slimy. Not everyone knows why they're so slimy. Some people think that sliminess helps to protect them from bacterial invasion and fungus, and it certainly does. Other people think that the slime on a gar may help them when they're swimming to make them a little bit faster, help them slip through the water. This is a lung that's been fixed and dried from a long-nosed gar. The gar was probably about 3 feet long. It takes up virtually the whole inside of its stomach cavity that isn't full of eggs or intestines. It's a really well-developed lung. It's the kind of lung that you'd expect to find in a turtle or maybe in a frog. It's actually better than a frog lung. My interest is trying to figure out how animals evolved air breathing, and the gar is a potential step along the way. So it'd be a shame if we lost these animals. They've been survivors, though, for millions of years, and I hope they're survivors for millions of years more.
Exciting sport fish or nuisance? Predator or prey? The jury is still out on the alligator gar, but one thing is for certain. The gar is an intricate part of the ecosystem wherever he is found. And what does the future hold? Will stories and legends be all that remain?
That fish has been around for millions of years, and they adapt to all kinds of conditions, low oxygen, hot water, cold water. They're as tough a fish and hardy a fish as there is, and I don't foresee them becoming endangered.
They keep removing them once they get to 4 or 5 feet. 10 years from now, there may not be nearly as many. Since they have such a long lifespan and breed it at such an old age, there's a chance that all of a sudden we'll be out of gars.
But I think there should be more work done on protecting animals before they become endangered. And the gars would be a perfect example.
The alligator gar, a link to the past that deserves a place in the future.